This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world.
Deb Kauble is back with us on Dreamland. She was Kathie Davis in Bud Hopkins' book, Intruders, and she was with us last summer in July. And if you are a subscriber, you can listen to that show where Deb will talk about her early experiences, and it was a really, really strong show. She's going to be with us on Zoom for subscribers soon. That will be announced as soon as we get a date together. But we're going to be talking about something else today, and I think it's beginning of a journey of dialogue that the whole experiencer movement needs to participate in. We are going down a road right now as a country and as a species, as the human race, of facing the fact that somebody else is here without knowing what that word else actually means. But there's going to be, unless the Pentagon manages to derail the demands being made by the United States Congress and that have been signed into law, and they will try to derail them, you may be sure. There's going to be a point in the next maybe even year or so when somebody in an official position says, we don't know who is here, but it's not us. And they've almost said that. Almost, but not quite. And there should be, as well, an assessment of the level of threat, because after all, the document that was that started all of this is called a threat assessment. So the question is this. There are a lot of questions. That's why Debbie's here, because she's going to help us answer. I consider Debbie to be one of the wise people of our experience. I think she has done a tremendous job of balancing the good and the bad in her experience. So welcome back to Dreamland after that long-winded introduction. Excuse me.
Well, thank you. I'm happy to be here. I always like talking to you.
You know, one of the things we didn't talk about too extensively, and this is how I would like to sort of start in, is your mother in the last interview. You mentioned, of course, that she was, just to give you an idea, the night the first real encounter happened, Debbie was they noticed a light out near their pump house, and then Debbie was on her way to a friend's house around the corner, and her mother had said, don't worry about the light, and she'd said that twice, I think. And then she suddenly, Debbie was at the friend's house, and her mother called and said, you've got to get home right away. And then Debbie had one of the great periods of contact anyone has ever remembered. But tell us about what your mother was like after that, because she must have been involved somehow.
Well, I don't know, maybe it was a week or so after the fact of the experience. Mom mentioned to me, she said she was just standing at the kitchen sink, looking out the window, doing whatever, and mentioned to me, she said, no, I just realized why I called you to come back home. And I'm like, okay, why? You know, she said, I saw a light around the bird feeder, and it was about the size of a basketball. And she said, at first I thought it was somebody driving down the side driveway, and I looked for a car, didn't see anything. Then I thought maybe it was somebody with the flashlight. Well, I looked for a beam, and the light didn't move off the bird feeder, but then it got smaller and smaller and smaller, and then it was gone. And she says, at that moment that it disappeared is when it came into my head to call you and tell you to come home. I'm like, oh, okay. It kind of freaked me out a little bit. I think right. I said something like, wish you'd told me that then, but I don't think it would have mattered. I'd still come home. But my mom was very, she made that comment when we saw the mark in the yard out of the blue. with no prior conversation of UFOs or anything. And she just said, oh, that's where the UFO landed the other night, our UFO. And I don't know why she said that either, but that was like, when she said that again, it was like somebody snapped their fingers in my mother's voice. And it was the trigger for me to start remembering a lot of stuff, not just that night, but
right.
As you know, as time passed, more and more came back to my conscious memory. And it was my mother who I actually, when I, at the end of the experience, whatever happened there at the end, when I was out on the patio after that ball of light had kind of looked me up and down and I heard my name being called, it was actually my mother who had stuck her head out the door and yelled my name. And again, my mother's voice, you know, snapped the finger and start, you know, I forgot what had happened just then and, you know, headed up towards her voice. So my mother had an experience, which I didn't even know about until Bud came out to do the begin his investigation and started asking everybody questions. And I had no idea that my mother had had some strange experience with a little boy chasing her through the woods when she was a little girl. And for some reason in her mind, while it just doesn't sound alien-like, for some reason in her mind, she connected that episode with all the stuff that was going on in our house. So, you know, and then like I told you before, my mom was adopted at two, from an orphanage in Louisville by a master sergeant in the army and taken to China and lived there for 2 years. And a lot is not known about her family. You know, what, right. we do know a little bit about them. They found my mom in the 80s and 90s. So she knew she had brothers and sisters, but we don't know a lot about their personal experiences. So, you know, I don't know if they all had stuff.
This tends to run in families, and I think my father was involved. My mother had a horror of monkeys coming in the windows. So that's about the only thing I ever heard from her that would suggest that she was in any way involved in this. But her family's country house, I should say, is a place where I had mucho contact when I was a boy, and also more recently, quite frequently. So my guess is it was in both families. I know it's in some contemporary members of my mother's family, but I'm not so sure about my father's. But it's definitely a family affair. And there are a lot of letters we get where people will say that this is part of my family. And how do you respond to that? Because it's very important if we are talking if people are beginning to ask us, what is going on? What is your experience? And not the way they ask us now, which is, what do you think's going on? But more, you know, what do you think is going on? How do we deal with this idea that this could be part of, that it's not sort of alien scientists, but maybe something else very different, even having to do with family?
Well, I've said for a long time to anybody who would listen that I've always, I feel like there's a lot of different things going on with a lot of different entities or, you know, life forces or species or whatever, with different agendas. But in my particular case, which is the only thing I can really speak on, there's something about extraterrestrial that doesn't feel right to me, that word. I don't feel like whatever I'm having the majority of my contact with comes from some other planet, other than maybe the fact we all did at one point. And, you know, we started up here and actually began somewhere else. But I feel like some of the things that I've had contact with have either been here all along and live right here with us, just in a different place that we haven't explored yet, like maybe deep in the ocean or under the ground. or maybe on a different dimension. You know, there are a few things I've seen through my life that have led me to feel like this is something that I've that maybe have be something that's right here alongside with us, but we aren't able to perceive them for the most part. I think we are all capable of it, but I think there's something different about the people like you and me who've had these experiences. Either the experience has triggered something extra in us that has enabled us to perceive what goes on. You know, our little slice of the pie is a little bigger from what we can see than what most people can see.
Yeah.
Or else we're born. Something happens in our genetics, you know, in our family before us, and then we're born with maybe a little extra wiring or a little extra something that helps us perceive. But, you know, J. Allen Hynek told my mother one time that he was beginning to feel like not everyone was able to see these things. And I feel that, you know, I have a lot of respect for him, and I feel that's correct.
Well, you know, there's an interesting study that's been done by Dr. Gary Nolan and Dr. Kit Green that Gary Nolan has talked about on Vice, I believe. I'm actually in part of this study. I haven't asked them much about my brain, but I can see it myself in my MRI scans. And the brains of people who can remember this have a different structure in them. There's a lot of what's called white matter connecting two areas of the brain called the caudate and the putamen in people who have these memories. And it led me to think, what if it's just this? It's just genetic that certain people have memories of this and most of us don't. And this is actually not like an alien visitation at all, but more part of life. I don't know how you respond to that idea, but...
Well, you know, to me, that would make sense, because like I've always said, my life has always been the way it is. And when I was a kid, I didn't know that it was different. I assumed everybody lived that way or saw things that we saw or I saw. You know, I didn't know that everybody didn't until I was in school and was talking about it, and, you know, people would start laughing. But so,
yeah, I know the feeling.
Yeah, and you do. And so I, you know, that's maybe we're just like, humans 2.1 or you know, 1.2 or whatever.
Well, you know, one of the things I've thought, I wrote this in a foreword to, I believe it was Jacques Vallée's book, Dimensions, the one of Jacques Vallée's books I wrote a foreword to. This is what evolution looks like when it is applied to a conscious mind. In other words, we can see it happening to us. Mm-hmm. And now we see this strange brain structure appearing in people, and what they don't know yet is whether or not it was there from the beginning of their lives or if the experience causes it.
Yeah.
And if, you know, since we don't know that, we don't know if it's that these people who happen to have this can see the experience, or the experience is something that only happens to certain people, and it causes the brain to change in such a way that because the person is trying to remember, and this is what the brain needs to do to make that happen.
Well, when I had when I first started having the ocular migraines, I got worked over real good by an ocular neurologist who did.
Let's back up a little bit, because actually, folks, we were talking about the ocular migraines before we started.
Yes.
So tell us a little bit about and understand this. When you hear Deb's history, you don't need to hear mine because it's the same. Go ahead.
Well, I thought there were a couple times in my life when I was awakened early in the morning with severe nausea and dizziness and stuff, went to the emergency room because I thought I was having a stroke, scared the hell out of me. And they couldn't find anything wrong. And so time passed. And then about 2017, I believe, I was in the plant by myself in my department at the end of the night. And I started seeing this little flash in the lower corner of my left eye. And then I started seeing triangle shapes that like were like beautiful, sparkly colors of pyramids that were rolling. And it was beautiful, but it scared the hell out of me because I was, you know, trying to figure out if it was coming from my eye, you know, covering one eye and then the other. It wasn't painful, but like I said, I thought I was having a stroke. So it scared me. The anxiety was terrific. And, but it's that part stopped after about 20 minutes or so, but then I was blind in the left eye for about another half an hour. So I did go to the emergency room, and everything was fine. So, but I called my doctor because I had not too long before that had both lenses replaced from cataract surgery. And I do have macular degeneration in both eyes, which
so
I was
I.
diagnosed with. I was diagnosed with that in my 30s, which is kind of unusual. And it is dry, so it's stable. But anyway, my eye doctor was alarmed and he said my eyes looked fine. So he sent me to a specialist in Indianapolis who is an ocular neurology specialist or whatever.
I've been down that road too.
Oh, she ran me through the gamut, you know, 10 tubes of blood, all kinds of blood, brain x-rays, MRI, MRA, CTA, all that jazz. And she said what I was having was called an ocular migraine. It was coming from the visual cortex of my brain, not my eye, that I had bright spots in my brain. And she showed them to my husband and I in these different places. And I'm like, oh my God, what is that? Am I having, you know, do I have two brain tumors? And she said, no, that they're believed to be just some kind of possible scar tissue from migraines and that it wasn't anything to be worried about. You know, it wasn't going to hurt me. That
Since I have them too, I know a lot about them, but we're going to pause for just a minute because we need to take a brief break. For those who are on the free side, we'll be right back.
Support unknowncountry.com and its great mission to make contact happen. Use our vast archive of interviews, meditations, commentaries, news, and Whitley Strieber audiobooks to expand your mind and your understanding of close encounter. Meet others who have similar interests on our active free message board or in our subscriber comments and Wednesday night chats. There is no other site like Unknown Country in or out of this world. Go to unknowncountry.com and subscribe today.
How curious are you? How much do you really want to know about the world you live in? There are, for example, very real conspiracies. We're talking about one of them today. And this is a place where if it's real, we're going to talk about it, but not if it's not real. So there's no confusion here. If we're talking conspiracy on Dreamland and on unknowncountry.com, it's because we can prove it, just like we can prove that the Roswell incident has been covered up. We can prove these things. We can prove that the abduction phenomena is in some way very real. We can prove that there are unusual materials in this world because some of them are right here in my possession. So, this is an unusual place. It's a unique place. And above all, it is a great place to explore. Exploring the unknowncountry.com archive is a really extraordinary experience. It's a place where you can regain what we are losing, which is a lost sense of wonder and a willingness and to explore the unknown. We live in a terribly difficult world right now. This place is an oasis of wonder. Join unknowncountry.com today. We're talking to Deb Kauble. Deb is the Kathie Davis of Bud Hopkins' book, Intruders, and the author of a marvelous book called Extraordinary Contact, Life Beyond Intruders. We talked extensively about extraordinary contact with Deb in July of 2021, but Deb is back with us, and she will be with us as well in our one of our weekend video sessions for subscribers. And we're basically taking a look at where the experience is going. And we're exploring just now the question of our own the similar health issues. And of course, because there's no studies, there's no way of knowing whether or not this type of health issue is even connected with contact. But let's go on about your eyes. You went to the ocular neurologist and you were told basically that you're having these ocular migraines. And let's go on from there.
Well, I'd never had done that before in my life. You know, I'd never experienced anything like that until that point. So it was kind of alarming to me. And then I mentioned to her about the two times when I'd been awakened by the dizziness. And she said those were likely migraines. I don't have them a lot, you know, and I'm not sure what triggers them other than maybe bright light. Light it seems to be the worst trigger for me.
Well, the light that you experienced, it was not ordinary light.
No, it was not. And I blame my eye conditions and possibly even this with my brain on that light. Even though I have no proof of it, I never had problems like that prior to that day. And my eyes were never right after that day. You know, I had gone to the emergency room the next day because they were swelled shut. And as I healed, I also became extremely farsighted. And I had not worn glasses before that. And so even now, these are threes. And these are just what I use for reading. You know, I have and even though I had my cataracts, my surgery, and they removed my lenses and replaced them completely, I still have to have reading glasses. I'm still at a three, but, or two and a half. The doctor likes me to do two and a half, but I see better with three. But I always have blamed that night for my eye problems because my eyes just were never right after that. And I feel like almost, okay, my eyes are like windows into my brain, you know, and that light was so intense. I know my eyes were closed and that, but yet the light was still so bright in my closed eyes that it hurt. So I don't know if it had more of an effect on, you know, my brain than I even realize.
Well, exactly. And, you know, in my case, I'm pretty much exactly in the same boat. It's interesting. And I just wonder how many other witnesses who have been exposed to this kind of light have also had have eye issues, because mine are essentially the same thing as yours are. I think I've had a little bit more vision damage than you have, but that doesn't mean it won't happen to you in the future. Hopefully it won't, but it might.
Yeah.
Now,
other things happened with my brain too, though. I have, you know, and this
yeah, the demyelination. I have those white spots also.
Oh, you do?
Oh, those yeah, are... absolutely. I've had them. In fact, the first brain scan I did in 1986, I guess it was, after I was afraid I was I had a brain tumor. You know, I didn't think this was real at first, which everybody already knows, but. The one thing that seemed to be odd about my brain was these areas of demyelinization, those little unknown bright spots, they were called UBOs. Mm-hmm. And they thought it might be related to multiple sclerosis, but I've not developed any symptoms of multiple sclerosis, and the UBOs are the same now as they were in 1986. But what are they and why did they happen? And do you think you had a lot of contact experiences when you were a child?
I wouldn't say a lot, but I had some. I definitely had one when I was six. Then I had another at least two more that I remember very clearly as a teenager, you know, like 17, 18. And then, of course, I was like 23 during June 30, 83. So
right. Now, when you tell us about the time that you ended up in the wrong house.
That's when I was little.
When you were little. Yeah, we talked about that a little bit in the last show. But I'm sure that listeners would like to hear that story again. And it relates to the childhood experiences that I think a lot of us have had, and maybe a lot of us have also buried, like I did.
Well, I even buried this. It was my mom that actually initially remembered it during conversation with Bud. You know, Bud had a way of, you know, interviewing you, and it would like, oh, I forgot. I remember this, you know.
Yeah, he was very good at that. Hey, Bud saved my life. And, you know, everybody knows we had a big fight, but that doesn't mean I don't love Bud. And because it's not so easy to get me to stop loving you. You have to scare me off pretty badly. And so I regret what happened between me and Bud, but that I have great respect for his efforts. You go ahead.
I was just a little kid. My sister had taken me to Detroit, Michigan with her. She had just gotten her driver's license. You know, she's 11 years older than me. So she had recently gotten her driver's license and got the okay by my parents to take me up to Detroit. The friend that she used to hang out with lived down the corner, or her grandparents lived a corner from us. And there another grandchild that was my age I used to play with. So Kathie was going to take me up there. She was going to see her friend Denise, and I was going to play with Eileen. That was my little friend. And it was just going to be an overnight trip. And I remember we had grilled cheese and tomato soup for lunch. I don't know why I remember that. I don't know, but I do. And the lady confirmed that with Bud. I remember we had grilled cheese and tomato soup. Then Eileen and I were outside playing in the backyard. A ball was kicked over the fence. I jumped over the fence to get the ball. And as soon as I got the ball, I realized I was lost. I didn't know where I was. And I didn't see my friend. So I walked around to the front of the house between the houses where I was at. It was like a cul-de-sac and the road was curved, you know, at the end of the cul-de-sac. And I saw what I thought was the house that I was supposed to be in. Got to remember, I was only at this place, you know, for an hour or two. So it wasn't like my neighborhood. And I walked into the open door. I saw the door open, so I went in. And I began to realize quickly that this was not the right place. Something wasn't right about it. I knew, I remember I felt uncomfortable, and I started to leave. And as I started to leave, a little boy stopped me. He was seemed to be my age, and he was blonde hair and had brown eyes, and he asked me if I would stay and play with him. And I was scared. I remember feeling afraid, but then I remember suddenly not feeling afraid and agreeing to go play with him in his toys. He took me to a room, which was what I thought was his toy room. But when I went into this room, it seems like the room was massive. You know, I don't recall any corners. I don't recall any lights, but yet it was all light. And I know that there was a sunken part in the floor, and I sat on the edge of it with my legs dangling down like of a swimming pool, you know, but there wasn't any water in it. It was just like a sunken living room kind of deal. I remember at one point looking up and seeing a red light on the wall and something coming out of the wall towards me. And I remember, so my memories are kind of disjointed, you know, but I remember the little boy had a thing in his hand that seemed like a toy that my brother and sister and I used to make out of old shoeboxes with that we'd cut a hole out of and put strings on and pluck it like a guitar, you know, and he set this on my lap and I plucked the string, and then I felt something poke me on the leg and it hurt, and I got scared and I jumped up and I tried to leave the room. And then I remember being back in the, I guess, living room or the front room of this house in front of the door. The door was open. And the little boy was asking me not to leave. And then his mother came from somewhere. She came rushing out. And I remember her being big and angry. And she said, "What is she doing in here?" Something like, "What is she doing in here? She doesn't belong here. She needs to get out now." And it's like someone shoved me out the door. I remember looking up and seeing my sister standing at the end of the walkway on the sidewalk. And I just remember feeling relief. It was my sister. So I was safe. you know.
And your older sister.
My older sister.
Yeah.
I walked over to her. I took her hand, and that was the end of it, you know. I don't recall her saying anything to me. I don't recall me saying anything to her. We just went back to where we were supposed to be, and that was the end of it. And then years later, when Bud came to interview everybody and the whole family was around, we were all talking about all kinds of stuff. And Bud had asked a question about me as a child. Had I ever been missing or anything? And I said, not that I recall. And Mom said, wait a minute. You were too young. Don't you remember this? And then they told me that I had disappeared from the backyard of this house, and that Kathie is the one who had gone. Police were involved, and everybody was out looking for me. And Kathie is the one that brought me home, had went out and found me and brought me back.
So you were, this is really very interesting, and we're going to get into it in just a moment for those who are listening to the commercials. But to those of you who are listening to the commercials, why not quit listening to them once and for all and subscribe to Unknown Country? We really need you now. And I'll tell you a little bit about why that is in a few minutes, but we'll be right back.
This is not communication. It's communion. Hundreds of thousands of people have claimed contact. That will change you. It changed me.
Lost in.
This was something that I kept buried for years. Strange things would happen. I didn't want anything to do with it anymore.
He came at me, and I fought for my life.
Ships started to pop up in the sky.
And there's this bizarre disk of light. And it is moving across the sky very fast.
The experience is often very terrifying.
If I felt fear, I would crawl under my covers, hoping that it would go away, whatever it was.
I know that we were put in that craft.
I knew I was going to go to another planet.
And the being was right next to my face.
He saw two shadow beings. That's when I felt like I was going to die.
I had a real encounter with something. Even if I had to live with the fear, is to know the truth, is to know.
We're talking to Deb Kauble. Her book is Extraordinary Contact. We talked about Extraordinary Contact last summer, and it is really very well worth your time. You can get it anywhere books are sold, on Amazon or Barnes & Noble, or if you have a local bookstore, you can probably ask for them to order it there. It's a wonderful, wise book and very well done. Deb writes with the same warm, wise, and intelligent voice with which she speaks. So
you're so kind.
Yeah. So if you want to let this experience embrace you somehow, and it's a hard experience and a very difficult one in many respects, Deb can help you there because she's done that. She has mastered her experience as best a human being can, I think. And Extraordinary Contact reflects that. Now, let's go back to that moment when you jump over the fence. And I think I've had experiences of being in a parallel universe, a number of them. Three of them were physical. And I think that is exactly what this was. I think it was a physical experience. And I have learned that if you are found in those in one of those worlds where you don't belong, they throw you out right quick. They do not want you there. And I know why. I think that because you have there a doppelganger, there's another you there, and the two must never meet. It would be like shorting out the universe and maybe destroying both of your lives in some arcane way, I don't know. But they seem to be more knowledgeable. They seem to be able to look into our world, but we can't look back. And so do you respond to any of that at all? Has this maybe been an experience where you kind of slipped into another version of the world?
Could be. I mean, I fully feel that that's something that can happen. I don't know. It just feels right to me. I've seen things that make me feel like, you know, there's other universes, and even my mother, you know, my mom was so, she always used to tell us kids, mind over matter. You can do anything with your mind. You just have to believe that you can, and you will, you can. And she would, you know, just, I mean, that's the kind of stuff that my mom used to tell us all the time. And I just feel like that, you know, that's true. Hell, I've even said a couple of times, I think there's as many realities and universes as there are minds. And each one of our minds is its own separate reality in here. And it plays out as we think it to happen.
There are a lot of physicists who would think that that's a pretty accurate statement.
I had that vision one time after June 30th. My brain kind of changed after June 30, 83 in more ways than just my eyes. Like I said, one strange thing is I found my old high school transcripts, and my IQ test was 111, which is nothing to, or 110 or 111, which is average, and, or, you know, I'm a fully functional adult. But then, you know, June 30, 83 happened. And then my late husband convinced me to try taking the Mensa test. And I'm like, dude, I can't even balance my checkbook. And he said, that's just because you don't have any money. You know, if you had money, you would care. So, but anyway, my Mensa test came back. I was at 135 at a Cattell, and another MM something was 141. And I thought, how does that happen? That's a big point spread in just a few years. And again, my brain went back to, my mind went back to June 30, 83, when it changed my eyes. I think it changed something else. And I had this brain explosion. And I told you, I was playing bubbles with my youngest son one day, one of those giant wands with all the holes in it, the big globs. And I whipped one of these big globs of bubbles right out in front of me, and it just hung there. And it was like slow motion, and my brain went bing, 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 bing. And I'm like, that is the universes. All these bubbles is a universe. And there's a me in every one of these, but everything is a little different. And where the bubbles touch, that little fine membrane where they become one briefly and fleetingly before they slide away, that's where communication and even inadvertently communication or jump can happen. You can slip. And when the world went to hell several years ago, the first thought that came in my mind is they need to turn off that Hadron Collider, because somebody has ripped a hole in my space-time continuum, and this crappy alternate reality is leaking in all over mine like a garbage bag, and I want to go home. That was the first thought in my mind. This is not
the childhood experience. Tell us about the experiences that gave rise to that thought.
You know, it happened after June 30th, 83, that all those kind of thoughts came.
Yeah.
Strange things came to my mind.
This is challenging us. It's challenging the whole human species. Anne used to say that always that she was a believer in the question, and one of the reasons was that if we have questions, the mind keeps growing. And what this is doing is it's giving us questions that we can't let go of. I mean, I can never let go of these questions, and neither could you or any of us. But at the same time, we can't answer them either. So the mind just keeps growing and growing. And your
the
IQ.
More questions I have.
Yeah,
the more
exactly.
questions I have.
And exactly. And your IQ goes up and up. And because you're struggling with this unknown that's in your life and it's real.
I'm stretching my mind to fit over this boundary that keeps moving.
Right. Like what you just described is a highly sophisticated vision of the way reality might work. And I'm remembering something in the last conversation we had. I'm trying to get it to my head, into my head, about all these shards.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, you remember that?
Yes, I was.
Okay, can you
kid.
Tell? Can you tell us about that? Because I think it relates a lot to what you just said.
And that I was really young when I had that dream.
The shard dream. That's it.
Yes.
Yeah, now I remember. I knew I was onto something. Go ahead.
Yeah, I was very young, but it was one of way back then. It was a lucid dream. When I have these lucid dreams, they stay with me when I wake up, and they become more ingrained in me. I was. For lack of a better way to put it, I was just existing in this darkness, and I was just there. I was. And in front of me, I saw this beautiful, bright, golden sun, and then it just exploded in front of me. And when it did, it was the most beautiful, magnificent thing with just an infinite number of little light droplets or shards that just shot out in every direction. And somebody, some disembodied voice spoke to me and said, "That is where I come from. That's me. That's all of us. We're all a part of this bright golden shard of light. And when each one of those little shards, I could see them going into bodies, into human bodies, into other kinds of bodies, into animals, into plants, everywhere that was life. This was life. And this was what people call God. You know, and that was, and whenever, and then I began to see some of them doing like coming back, you know, and then it was like someone was telling me they go out and they have life and they do things and they come back and they bring this experience back with them. And that's us. So, you know, have you ever seen like an atom that explodes, except all this stuff is whirling around it? All these little shards of light were going everywhere. And I was just a little kid when I had that dream. It had always left an impact on me. It was spectacular.
Yeah, it's an awfully strange dream.
Well, I know, but I was a strange little kid. But like I said, I didn't know I was any different than anyone else at the time.
Yeah, it reminds me a lot of the secret school experience, which I've often wondered the degree to which it was real. I wrote a book about it called The Secret School, which was about confronting and learning about these things as a child. And I, of course, because I was a child, I can't say that the memories I describe in the book are really exactly what happened at all. Mm-hmm. But there was enough physical evidence to suggest that something had happened. And I wonder if this has been in your life, was in your life. I think it was in your life when you were a child, or you would never have time, or I should say, slipped into that parallel world. That's the kind of thing that happens to people who are involved in this.
There's a couple times I can recall as a young person on my own, just going about my life in the house doing dishes or whatever, and all of a sudden, it wasn't like getting dizzy. It was something different. And like I suddenly felt like the world around me slowed down, and I had to hold on to something solid in that world to stay there, you know, until it was different than a dizzy feeling. I mean, we've all had dizzy spells and, you know, whatnot. This was weird. This was something else. you know, I've had that happen a couple times, and it's definitely bizarre. It's like I was about ready to jump somewhere else and had to hold on to this reality to stay here. I had to hold on to something.
our brains are at the edge, all of us. They're at the edge, and there's a very much of a shadow line at that edge between seizure and real experience. Some of us are fortunate to have, like you had, multiple witness involvement.
Yeah.
Which is really good, because that tells you that, yes, it partly it's the way my brain works or doesn't, but partly also this is real.
Right. Well, my brain didn't leave a mark in the yard that lasted for 2 years. You know,
exactly.
The neighbors are the ones who reported the bright flash and the roaring sound like the airplane. Even the one neighbor said that all of her TVs turned red, and she thought someone was coming to get her, was trying to get in her house too. And, you know, so, I mean, and then when I was with my two girlfriends out in the country driving around stalking their boyfriend that time, it wasn't just me. It was two other people. There have been multiple times in my life when I've had very strange experiences, and other people have been with me. And
yeah.
I would feel like I was really like losing my mind if I didn't have that, if I wasn't fortunate enough to have other witnesses and I still have dirt from the mark in the yard, by the way. I found my samples.
You did.
Have
they ever been analyzed?
Bud took some back with him when he came the first time and had the lab look at them. And what they found is in Intruders.
I remember now that you say that. But
go
ahead.
I found them. I don't know why, but I had taken a bunch of it and put it in separate plastic bags, and I'd carry it around with me everywhere I've gone. And fortunately, and I thought I'd lost it in the tornado in 2013, but they were in the bottom of an old cedar chest that had not gotten sucked away in the tornado, but was covered in debris. And I did find them in my cedar chest. So I still have a whole bunch of samples. If anybody wants one, I'd be happy to give them one.
Well, we might have a little bit better ways of analyzing them now.
I know it's pretty old. I don't know how much good it is at this point, you know.
Well,
but
you never know.
Weird.
Let me ask around, and I'll see if I can find someone who might want to take a look at them, who can be trusted to actually tell the truth, which is a big thing, you know, because one of the things that happens is when a lot of scientists, they see something, oh my God, it is anomalous. I can't say that. It'll ruin my career. And so they don't tell you the truth. But I know some that will, who don't care, who's so powerful, like Gary Nolan. I mean, he's a very powerful guy at Stanford, and he has no reason to care. He'll just do it and tell you the truth. And if it's weird, he'll probably even go on this show and talk about it. So send me one of the samples. We'll give you my address off the air. I mean, it's a public address. It's no secret, but I don't want to waste everybody's time. But I do want to do one thing with some of your time. And those of you who are on the free side, listen up.
Three words: advanced aerial threat. Who in the CIA, NSA, DIA tells at least the United States of America that we're not alone in this universe? We have never been alone in this universe.
The U.S. government really has kept that secret, not only from the American people, which is bad enough, but even kept it from itself.
The UFO community has been portrayed as conspiracy theorists and tinfoil hats, and we're crazy. And the government is now admitting that UFOs are real, and disclosure is here. Suddenly, they're our friend? No.
America's defense establishment is finally admitting some of what it knows.
This could have been a chance to say we're going to collaborate with the representatives of the people in what is supposed to be a government of, by, and for the people.
If what they tell you is the truth, there is no need to withhold it from public.
We've entered a quantum age, making a leap not only in technology, but also in consciousness. Companies are now creating non-sentient replacement humans. They look just like you and I. They're intended for customer service and things such as that, but these neons, as they're called, could be more nefarious than that.
We're dealing with a fight. There are forces behind the scenes that doesn't want any of this information to come out.
There's still a lot of truth that has yet to be revealed.
I was one of those quote unquote men in black, but I realize it's probably better now to be known as men in white, bringing truth to the topic.
The problem with the truth is the truth might be terrifying.
We're talking to Deb Kauble. Deb is the Kathie Davis of Intruders. She's had a lifetime of extraordinary experiences and extraordinary contact, and she's written a book called Extraordinary Contact. Deb, where can we find you on the internet? Debshome.com, I believe it's called. Is that correct?
Yeah. That's correct.
Okay. Debshome.com is where she lives online, and I'd like to start talking now a little bit about the issue of what do we do if someone says this is all real, someone official, the government, and at some point there's a lot of media that works. I won't say is government controlled, but it works very hand in hand with the government. And so they may say to a lot of the media, well, don't talk to the abductees. But that won't be everybody. There will be big media that wants to talk to the abductees. And what do we say? What do we say? Because we don't know for sure. They're going to all be saying, Were you abducted by aliens? The aliens this, the aliens that. Where do we go with that, Deb?
Well, I've been telling the same story for the last 38 years, and I'll just keep telling them the same thing I know, you know. But they, it kind of worries me a little bit because...
Me too.
I'm afraid that there's going to be people out there who are going to look at us like we're some kind of demons or something that have to be.
They already do.
They do, but I mean the really, really dangerous people. I mean, I'm more scared of people than I am aliens.
I'm at this point. In the process of winding up my whole public appearance thing. I'm not going to be doing very many more shows where I'm physically there because of the danger, basically, of people coming after me with a gun and blowing my head off. I get plenty of email that not recently has there been anything that was really, I wouldn't say violent or threatening. That I've had, that at times in my life. But... I just think this is a very dangerous, it will become a very dangerous time for all of us, especially those who have a public face.
Yeah, I kind of feel that way a little bit. You know, I'm going to have to be extra vigilant and aware, but I've always been a survivor and always been, you know, vigilant. So, but that I also do want people, I don't buy into the whole fear thing that the government is trying to. I understand that it's a way to get attention and maybe money, funding for the, you know, as a threat to our national security. But to be honest with you, I feel like if they were going to, you know, do something to us like that, they would have done a long time ago, because I think they're perfectly capable of that. And, I don't want people to walk. I don't, even though I have fear myself, it's not for the phenomena. It's for how people are going to react to it when they realize that it's real.
Yeah, exactly.
You know?
Exactly.
I don't want people like you and me to walk around being afraid their whole life, because that fear is healthy, but you know.
I think that might happen to us. And after all, a threat assessment, that's what they called that document that they, where they said that, yes, this stuff is unknown, of unknown origin, and they're going to do a threat assessment. Now, how disingenuous can you be? Because, let's face it, this same functionality was described in, I believe, the Twining memo in 1947. I think I've got the right one. That is definitely a real document. It was found using conventional means in the National Archives, and it's not something that was placed there by some jerk or anything like that. And so they've had 70 years to figure out whether or not this is a threat.
Exactly.
And now they're saying we're going to assess it, ooh, whether or not it's a threat.
In other words,
the disclosure that's going on is itself a lie.
Yeah. It's at the end of the day, I'm not looking to any government in the world for any kind of disclosure. We've talked about this before. I feel like disclosure is going to come from people like you and me and other people who've had these experiences. They're going to speak out. And it's the entities, whatever they are, that are going to control it, the narrative.
I think they control the narrative now.
Right.
Because they're the ones who are, I mean, they could, they came into your backyard easily enough, and they came to my country house easily enough, and to this very apartment easily enough. They can go anywhere they want to without being seen or detected in any way. This place is loaded with surveillance equipment, and I've just got a couple of audios and one video that might suggest the presence here.
Yeah.
They're that careful. But the last time I had a physical experience with them was during a meeting yesterday afternoon. This is February the 1st. It was January the 31st at 3:00 Pacific time. Someone during the meeting tapped on this shoulder and shook the cloth of the shirt with their fingers. In other words, it wasn't a nervous tick or anything.
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't see anybody. There's a camera. I'm pointing at it. You can't see it. It's right up there. It didn't see anything.
So well, what do we do with that? Them, we see them when they want us to see them.
Right.
And, you know, I read the reports about them shutting off nuclear missile heads. Okay, I'm kind of good with that. That's fine with me.
Right.
I'm not going to complain. So, you know, it's coming.
Yeah.
I think that, like, I feel like part of why I was able to finish my book when I did during the COVID shutdown, I took a negative and made a positive into it, you know, and got that take done. And then everything kind of dovetailed with the UAP report and Intruders and Missing Time being republished and put back out at the same time, which that was not planned. But it happened that way. And I just feel like everything is happening the way it should be. And I'm just going to trust my instincts and follow my flow to where it takes me, because I feel like this time in life, in my life and in the world, is why I was born, why I'm here.
I agree. I think most of us feel that sense of mission. Even those who are not in the public eye feel that sense of mission. And I think a lot of people will come forward, hopefully, to form a unit to raise a loud and big voice in a world.
I think there are millions and millions of people in the world like you and me.
Yeah.
And
in the third half hour, we're going to talk about people who are wanting to co-opt this for their own political beliefs, and religious beliefs, which is going to happen. Deb, you made a reference a moment ago to being thought of, people thinking of you as a demon. And that happens to me all the time. I mean, I'm demon number 666 in a lot of people's eyes. You know, one time I had in New York State, where we used to live in upstate New York, In New York State, you have to get a new license plate every year or so. I don't remember how often it is, but I went in to get my new license plates, and they just picked them up at random out of the stack. And license plate was UFO 666. And
oh my.
I said to the lady, look, I don't know if you know who I am, but I can't have this license plate. And she looks at me and she says, Mr. Strieber. I said, yes. Oh, my God, she says, I'm scared to death now. I'm not going to give you the license plate. You won't last a week.
Oh, my Lord.
So I got another license plate. But, you know, we're vulnerable. We're very vulnerable. And there are a lot of us. And so we're going to in the third half hour, we're going to be talking more about this. But right now I want to talk about what happens if the threat assessment is actually done and the report is made, a public report to Congress. And the report says there are aliens here and they abduct people and do things to those people that cause them to become fellow travelers. They make it's a Stockholm syndrome effect, and these people are themselves part of the danger. What do we do then, Debbie? Because that could happen too.
Mm-hmm. I don't know. I don't think of myself as a danger. I think of myself as loving and caring and wanting to help people. And I guess I'll just try to continue to be that way and show them that I'm not scary, except for maybe to my sons when I've caught them doing something they weren't supposed to do. Yeah.
Well, you know, I just think that the whole community needs to open up a discussion about all of these different levels of possibility, because they could also say that we're victims, that we've been duped. There's something out that was declassified in England in 1997 called the Condyne Report, which says that these plasmas, as they call them, are dangerous. They cause physical problems, which you and I have just been discussing. That would be true, certainly. And they call them plasmas, not ships or anything like that. But that they also cause people to think things happen that didn't happen. And therefore, another possibility is that they will say, well, all of these people who claim to be alien abductees, it didn't happen.
Prove it.
Well, yeah, explain the physical,
effects.
I mean, why do we both have similar eye problems, similar strange marks in our brains? Why are we all like this?
And why do we have witnesses, other people?
Multiple witnesses, like at my cabin. I mean, many people had direct contact at my cabin.
Yeah.
Yeah. So it's, you know, I have zero trust in the official's ability to handle this. I'm not saying that they're evil conspirators or anything. I just don't think they can handle it. And I don't think, because we have struggled mightily as a community to handle what we know of it. How can they possibly handle it, especially because the great majority of them are going to be outsiders? Mm-hmm. They're going
to be. I think we just all need to work together. The scientists like Gary Nolan, people like you and other experiencers, we all have to come together and work as a group, you know, together.
Okay. We're going to, for those who are leaving us now, I'm saying goodbye. Debbie's book is Extraordinary Contact, A Life Beyond Intruders. Her website is debshome.com. And we're going to now be talking about political issues. And there's a big reason for that. We have divided in the United States at least, into a far left and a far right. And us Close Encounter witnesses, for the most part, are in the middle. between those two groups for a lot of reasons. Not too many of us are solidly entrenched in either group, with the result that the far left cancels me because they figure I must be a member of the far right since I'm not among them. And the far right cancels me because they figure I must be a member of the far left because I'm not among them. We're the outsiders. What do the outsiders do in a situation where their lives are suddenly having a bright light shined on them and all of this political tension becomes entangled in our lives and religious, with religious people saying they're angels, they're demons, and the political people claiming the visitors, the aliens are on my side. What do we do with all that? So, subscribers, we'll just keep on keeping on and get set for an interesting ride, I think.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by UnknownCountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.